Hello, and welcome to this introduction to the ARM Embedded Platform and to the world of microcontrollers in general. My name is Renato Grottesi, and I work in the software GPU team of the ARM office in Trondheim. The slides for this presentation are available at the address on the top right and the source code in my GitHub repository. All links are available in the video description. Let's start discussing why it's important to learn how to use microcontrollers. The first advantage of using microcontrollers is that they use very little power, so they can run on small batteries or solar power for a very long time. They are also very small and don't need active cooling, so they can be used in many interesting scenarios like wearable electronics, drone control, implants and any sort of automation tasks. Finally, it's worth noting that gadgets with microcontrollers have higher selling values than a simple application on a phone that could do the same task. For example, look at MIDI controllers, gamepads, smartwatches, persistent vision displays, or Pokeball Plus for Pokemon Go. However, working with microcontrollers can be challenging due to their limits. As we'll see later in this course, writing performance firmware that fits in a few kilobytes of ROM and can execute in even fewer kilobytes of RAM can be quite difficult, but very rewarding. The most used feature of microcontrollers is the access to general purpose input-output pins. You can connect any kind of components to a microcontroller, read signals from sensors, write digital or analog signals to actuators, and use digital protocols to drive other integrated circuits. Now let's take a look at the most common components that you can use with a microcontroller. The first category includes components to read user inputs. Buttons are the simplest. They use a single digital pin and they are either pressed or not. Keyboards are slightly more complicated as their keys are usually arranged in a matrix circuit where a signal is multiplexed in each row and each column is then sampled to check for key presses. In this way, one can read a full N by M keyboard using log2 of N plus log2 of M input-output pins. Joysticks and touchscreens take two analog signals for the X and Y that need to be read using some of the few analog input-output pins of the microcontroller, which has an internal analog-to-digital converter to digitalize the signals into bits. Rotary encoders, linear potentiometers and soft potentiometers are also using a single analog pin. The most common multimedia devices that you can hook to microcontrollers are microphone and piezos, which need a single analog I/O pin. If you want to read a camera, you may need a single analog pin if that's CAN-based, or a wall SP I2C connection if they have an internal memory storing the wall image. Sensors are some of the most interesting components to read, and most of them require a single analog pin. There are sensors for almost anything, like light intensity, atmospheric pressure, weight, humidity, soil moisture, temperature, gravity, compass, current, air pollution chemicals, proximity, and many more. If you want your microcontroller to interact with the world, you can use different types of actuators. DC motors just spin, but you can control their speed using pulse width modulation in a single digital pin and use them in drones or cars. Servo motors can move in a range of usually 180 degrees, depending on the input pulse width modulation signal. They are very useful to articulate joints or robots. And when using servos, make sure to know the torque that your application needs. Stepper motors can move with a very specific amount of degrees when controlled with their 4 digital pin system. They are used in machines that need to move to a very specific position, like printers, vending machines, or disk controllers. Solenoids can be controlled with a single digital signal and they either retract or push a metal arm. If you ever played a pinball machine, they are full of those solenoids. Electromagnets are controlled by a single digital pin and they have various usages like locks or levitation systems. Relays are used to control high voltage by manipulating a switch with an electromagnet that is controlled by a low power voltage coming from an analog pin of a microcontroller. Another way that your microcontroller can interact with the world is from outputting multimedia signals. To output sound through a speaker or a piezo, you just need a single analog pin. But you may either use a single digital pin with pulse width modulation to make vintage music. You can control a single LED with a single digital pin, or you can use multiplexers to control an LED matrix in the same way that you read from a keyboard matrix circuit. When interacting with LCD or OLED displays, you probably need to set up a SPI or I2C connection. Finally, there are a lot of other components that are used to make the previous ones interact between them. Timers are used to float some work from the microcontroller, and they can control external components or send back interrupts to the microcontroller. Shift registers are used often together with analog-digital converters. Multiplexers allow you to expand the GPIO pinout by reading or writing at different time slices. Transistors are useful to control components with a higher voltage. Resistors can help limiting currents to components with a lower tolerance. Capacitors help stabilizing currents, and diodes help prevent current from flowing in the wrong direction. Flip-flops and memory can be used to buffer I/O. The list of components that are presented are the most common ones, but be aware that there are plenty more to use with your microcontroller. And now a few warnings so that you don't end up frying some of them. While microcontrollers usually work in the 3.3 or 5 volt range, components can work at any range. Match the proper voltages using transistors or relay to scale up, and voltage dividers that you can implement with a few resistors to scale down the voltage. Also, remember to make use of resistors to limit currents, since some components like LEDs can burn if the current is too high. Some microcontrollers are tolerant to high voltages if you set the pins to open drain, so please learn about that configuration and the pull-up and pull-down ones. And finally, remember to connect all the grounds of your components together when using different power supplies, or you will get into very inexplicable behaviors. Let's now take a look at some cool projects that can inspire you on how to use the components discussed before. Here are some links to global and local websites. You can find many nice ideas in Hackaday, Magazine, and Instructables. You can join the Trondheim Make Fair to meet with local enthusiasts, or you can become a member of Hackaim to get access to their 3D printers, solderers, CNC machines, and any other tools that can help you with your projects. You can also follow some nice YouTube channels like Greg Scott, The 8-Bit Guy, and Derek Barnas, where you can learn about modern and vintage electronics. First project I want to show you is the suspended plotter that I made for the Trondheim Maker Fair. The basic idea is to have a pen hanging from two non-stretchable threads, whose lengths can be controlled using two stepper motors. Each motor has a 3D printed pulley where the thread winds up, and the steppers are controlled by a microcontroller that reads a vector graphics file stored in a USB stick, and uses Bezier curves and the Pythagorean theorem to calculate the target length of the threads. When the pen is not supposed to leave a mark in the board, a servo motor pushes it away from the surface. This is a video of the plotter drawing an ananas. You can see the servo pushing away the pen from the paper when it doesn't need to leave a mark. Porting the 3G reader to run in a microcontroller was quite challenging, but since I still had some RAM to spare, I also added a web server running in the microcontroller that exposes an interface to add files to the USB stick and start the plotting. Another project coming from a colleague in the Trondheim ARM office is this virtual pinball emulator. While the video game itself runs in a powerful x86 machine, it connected a few microcontrollers using USB. One microcontroller is in charge of driving the LCD matrix display, another drives some solenoids that emulate the banks of a real pinball, and another reads the buttons and the plunger. The next project is the arcade machine that you can play with in the Trondheim ARM office if you decide to join us. The microcontroller inside reads the status of all the buttons and exposes a USB human interface device for a couple of joysticks. The Mali Power development board that lie on the top of the cabinet runs Android and drives the display and audio of the system. A very simple project that can be done with microcontrollers and some piezos is a MIDI controller that reads the vibrations of the piezos and translates them as USB MIDI signals to drive a drum synthesizer. USB MIDI is a well-defined protocol and you can use it to create inputs for any instrument you can think of. We already seen that piezos can read sounds or vibration and that they can produce sound. But another interesting application is to vibrate them at a specific frequency that vaporizes water. You can use it to make a humidifier or a desalinator, for example. Here you can see the Arduino Bob robot, which is a standard beginner project with open source 3D printable parts. It uses the ultrasonic sensors to avoid obstacles and servos for the leg movements. The final project I want to show you is something that I implemented in the Trondheim ARM office to automate the reset of some boards for our automatic testing infrastructure. What you can see in this feature is a set of 11 boards whose grounds are all connected and a microcontroller that resets them. A cable was soldered on the reset pin of each board and connected to the microcontroller in an open drain configuration, since the board uses 12 volts while the microcontroller is 12 volts tolerant but runs at 5 volts. The microcontroller runs ARM Embeds operating system and runs a remote procedure call server connected to the internal network. Thanks to this setup, we can easily reset a board remotely using a wget from the command line. I hope that seeing some projects got you inspired and trying and making some of your own, and you can follow the links in the video description for more information. Let's now take a look at ARM's embed platforms and see some programming examples. ARM Embed OS is a free and open source embedded operating system. It provides the operating system and a set of tools to develop, emulate, and debug for the platform. ARM maintains the documentation for all the APIs at os.embed.com/docs and offers a forum where developers can share their problems and solutions. If you are familiar with Arduino, Embed is pretty much the equivalent product from ARM that works on the Cortex M microcontrollers. And even some Arduino boards are now switching to Embed. Embed have been offering an online IDE and compiler for many years now, but it also supports offline compilers like Yotta, MicroPython, and plain Mac files. If you need to do some low-level debugging, Kale is a standalone IDE that supports JTAG. You can find a list of all the Embed supported boards following the link on the screen. The target platform for the following examples is the popular Microbit board that has a nicely defined C++ API from Lancaster University to access all its sensors, buttons, LEDs and Bluetooth connection. Now, let's take a look at how to create a simple program using the online compiler. Let's start with a simple example on how to play music using a digital pin of the Microbit. As I mentioned before, microcontrollers often have a dedicated internal counter that can be configured to offload some work that can run in parallel, and we can make use of those counters to configure a pulse width modulation signal that gets emitted in one of the digital pins of the Microbit. The sound waves will be squared, but you can implement a very simple RC low-pass filter to make it sound nicer. In the graph on the right, you can see how PWM is used to simulate analog sprites to control speeds in DC motors or brightness in an LED. Now that we know how to output a wave, we need to learn which frequencies we want to output for each note, and we need to translate that into microseconds, since that's what the internal counter understands. The next step is to match the name of the notes with the microseconds value using a simple lookup table. This is a very common programming practice in microcontrollers, where you want to precalculate results that depend on difficult mathematical operations to save runtime power. Keep in mind that the compiler is extremely smart, and it will likely optimize or lookup table values that can be accessed at runtime if you declare the table as a constant. Finally, you can create a simple loop where you set up the note volume with a set analog value, the frequency with set analog period microsecond, and the duration with a simple wait microsecond. While procedural music generation is nice if well done, you may want to play a song. You can surely find many pieces of songs by using Google, but some of them will be very badly coded, and when you try to flash them into the device, you will get a region RAM overflowed with stack error. That means that some data, which is statically stored in the stack, uses so much space that it overflows into the dynamic memory region. To mitigate the memory usage, start by making sure that the nodes use a single byte, since they shouldn't be more than 256. And please calculate the greatest common divisor of all the node durations, then use it to factorize the nodes as it multiplies, since music is often structured into bars of fixed size and fixed division. And here you have the simple code to play a song as an array of values into our previous lookup table of frequencies, together with an array of nodes duration in milliseconds. To use the embed online compiler, you need to visit the os.embed.com website, then click on the compiler in the top right corner. This will open a web page with all your projects on the left, and where you can create a new project clicking the new button on the top left. Set the platform target for BBC Microbit. Choose a template that you want to use for your project. In this case, we are using an empty program. And write the name of your program. In this case, we are going to call it Synth. This is an empty project. Let's now try to add some files. I've already did this project before, so just move some files over. We copy-paste the main and all its dependencies. Now let's take a look at the source code. The main programs includes microbit.h, that is the only required line to get the microbit libraries imported in your projects. Then it defines a note enum, an array of periods that we discussed before in the slides, and includes two files containing two songs. After that, the program tries to generate a sawtooth wave. Then it plays all the notes one after another, plays the Mario melody, then the Other World melody, and finally the Pirate melody. All Microbit programs ends with release 5 bit before return 0. Now let's try to compile this program. As you can see, the program cannot find microbit.h because we included it explicitly, but the online IDE offers you a fix it button. Let's click the button. The dialog offers us a choice to where to import the Microbit library from. You can go with the one with the most imports. After the import is complete, the compiler is compiling the code and generating the binaries. Afterwards, your browser will download the .exe file containing the program. On the right side of the screen, you can see how much flash memory and RAM your program is using. Now you can plug the MacroBit to your computer using USB. That will mount a new driver where you can copy the .exe program. After the copy is finished, the MacroBit will reboot and your program will be running. This is an image of how I connected a female audio jack to the MacroBit, to pins 0 and ground. And now, let's listen to the melodies played by the MacroBit. We can record the output of the MacroBit using a microphone cable connected to a computer. Then we can open Audacity to check the waveform. If we scroll in a bit of the song, we can see all the square waveform exactly as we expected. And if we scroll at the beginning where the notes increase in frequency, we can see the square forms getting tighter and tighter as the pitch of the notes increase. Though we only checked square wave music, many microcontrollers have analog pins that use the internal digital to analog converter to emit a value between 0 and the max voltage. If you want different sounds, you can use more processing power to emit different wave shapes. And if you have enough RAM, you can even store a wavetable and use it to emulate real-world instruments. Now that you know the basics for microcontrollers input-output, let's take a quick look at how to make it communicate with other more complex devices. One of the oldest and simplest protocols is the Universal Asynchronous Receiver Transmitter, abbreviated as UART, and also known as RS-232. The transmission only uses one wire where a device transmits and another receives the data. Two devices only need to agree on which baud to use and share the same ground to make sure that they read the right voltage values. The transmitter keeps a high level when it is nothing to send, then it emits a low level value for one baud, followed by the 8-bit data, and then at least one baud of high bit. The receiver samples the signals at A or 16 times the baud and waits for the beginning of a transmission. Then it stores the 8-bit in a shift register, and finally it copies the byte in the internal register. While this protocol is very easy to implement and use, it is quite inefficient from a speed point of view, because the reader needs to read at a fraction of its clock to accommodate the supersampling of the signal. Serial Peripheral Device, abbreviated SP, is a faster protocol where the sender and the receiver share a clock signal. Adding this extra cable, the two devices can transmit data at the same frequency of the internal clocks. SP also standardizes the use of two different cables for the transmission, so that the master can send to the slave at the same time as the slave can transmit to the master. There is also an extra cable that the master can use to enable or disable the slave, but such cable is not necessary if the master only drives one slave. With multi-slave configurations, the slave select connection are inevitable, but they can be reduced to one in a disjointed configuration, at the cost of extra software cycles and transmission latency. Another popular microcontroller protocol is the Inter-Integrated Circuit, abbreviated I2C. It only uses three wires and supports multi-master, multi-slave, but it implements a packet switch protocol, which is rather computational heavy. A different protocol that can be implemented inside the microcontroller is the more familiar universal serial bus. USB has many classes of devices that you can import in your project to implement keyboard, mouses, joysticks, MIDI controllers, mass storage devices, and many more. Some microcontrollers offer a USB port that you can connect to the computer. But if they don't have one, you can easily cut an old USB cable and connect its four wires to VCC, ground, and two digital pins. Finally, let's take a look at the most common ways to make your microcontroller into one of the things in the Internet of Things. Many microcontrollers come with a Wi-Fi chip already, and they offer APIs to receive and send TCP IP packets. Other models have a Bluetooth Low Energy interface which uses a lot less power, but the BLE software stack may use quite a lot of space in the RAM. Finally, not all the things in the Internet of Things need to be portable. If your device is fixed, probably an Ethernet connection will work just fine, and as a bonus, you can use the power over Ethernet to avoid using batteries or external power sources. Let's now take a look at a more complex software example, like a breakout video game that runs on a microbit. Since the device doesn't have a proper display, I bought a small LCD module which also comes with 128 KB of extra RAM. The module came with an open source library that I could import into my embed project and test that everything works as expected. After a few experiments with the provided API, I found out that it was implementing double buffering of the graphics to avoid showing updates of the frame buffer during screen refresh, which is common practice. However, I noticed that the overall refresh speed wasn't what I was expecting by checking at the maximum clock of the LCD controller and the RAM. Checking the code, it turns out that the speed clock frequency was set at 9 MHz while it should have been set at 15 MHz. After fixing the error, I doubled the initial 4 frames per second, but the rendering was still quite slow. Let's check this simple drawing example where the whole screen is cleared in white, then a 4x4 black square is rendered, and finally the frame buffer is flashed to the LCD display. While it's common practice to swap the whole frame buffer in desktop graphics, when we deal with microcontrollers, we need to be smart and only do minimal updates. In this refactoring of the previous function, we now render the white background color over the old 4x4 square, then we render the black 4x4 square in the new position, and finally we swap all the region of the frame buffer that includes both the clearing and the new drawing. With this small addition in complexity, we achieved a 99% reduction of bandwidth from 20 KB to only 64 bytes. Now that we know how to draw the breakout wall, let's try to animate it so that it bounces on the corners of the screen. Here, we read the code that sets up the screen, does the initial clearing, then enters the infinite game loop where we calculate the delta time since the last iteration, draw over the old ball position, then call an updatable float function to update the position of the ball and draw it at the new position. If we check the updatable float function, we can see that it contains the current position and velocity of the ball in two pairs of floats. It calculates the new position by multiplying the velocity for the delta time, it updates the global integer coordinates of the ball, and finally it flips the ball velocity if it hits the wall. While you may not find any problem with the proposed solution, you need to take into consideration that the Cortex-M0 in the microbit doesn't have the hardware support for floating point arithmetic. That means that those trivial multiplications will translate into calls to the 273 assembly instruction of the IAB FMUL function that will use a lot of ROM and will need a lot of time to complete. Luckily for us, we can use another trick to deal with decimal values using only integers, fixed point values. The microbit is capable of 16-bit arithmetic, and since the screen resolution is within 256 on both axes, we can represent a position using 8 bits, with 1 bit to spare for the sign and 7 bits for the decimal part, which translate to approximately 0.008. With this format, we get several single cycle operations, like extracting the integer with a shift right by 7, sum and subtract directly between fixed point values, and even multiply fixed point values by integer values. Only multiplication between fixed point values needs some extra handling, but we are not using it in this example, so we don't need to build in the whole libfixmatlab. Here, you can read the new updatable fixed function that approximates quite well the old updatable float function, using a lot less ROM and a lot less CPU cycles. The next big step to implement our breakout game is to draw the paddle and the bricks. On a computer program, you will load images from a file system, but we don't have such luxury on a standard microcontroller. What we can do instead is to create a small tool that reads your graphics and converts them in static C header that can be included in the program. I suggest that you use PNG as the image format, since it is lossless and libpng is easy to use and has a lot of online tutorials to help you. Here is the main function of the PNG2H utility that I made for this project. I didn't include the code for the readpng file function, but it's very easy to find using Google. And here is the code for the process.png file that reads the raw image in memory represented with 8 bits per red, green, blue and alpha, converts each pixel to our target format that uses 5 bits for red, 6 for green and 5 for blue, then prints out the value of the pixel in an output that resembles a C struct. Here we can see an example of how the utility translates the ball image into an IC header. Now that we can draw the ball, paddle and bricks with minor updates, it's time to complete the breakout game by implementing collision detection and reaction. Here you can see the basic implementation of such an algorithm that bounces the ball in the paddle or loses a life if missing, followed by a double for loop that checks the collision of the ball with all the 64 bricks, which can of course be optimized. Since the ball is 4x4 pixels, it can only intersect with at most 4 bricks, so let's translate the ball position in terms of the 8x8 bricks matrix and use that to only check 9 bricks instead of 64. Also note how the code only clears out the bricks that have been hit to save the screen bandwidth. Bricks are only drawn at the beginning of the game and cleared out when hit by the ball. You can of course review the code at your pace and check it out from a GitHub repository. To compile the breakout game, we can use the command line instead of the online IDE. Let's start by checking out the code. You can visit my GitHub page, then click on code, and then copy. Make sure that Git is installed. In this machine, it is already installed. Now clone the repository. And then you can inspect the code. Inside the breakout folder, you can see a setup.sh file that will configure and build the code. A source folder with all the source code, and a iota.json and module.json, which are the configuration files for iota. You can see that the setup script is using iota to build, so we need to install it first. The Lancaster University offers a webpage where you can find all the instructions. In my case, I'm going to install it on Linux. Let's start by following the link that tells you how to install the basic iota. Here, we also scroll to the Linux sections and we copy-paste the line where iota is installed. My apt is already updated, so I don't need to copy that part. And we are not going to install pip using easy install, because that is an updated method. Now that all the tools are installed, let's install pip. We are going to use the Python 3 version of pip, which is more updated. For install yotta itself, instead of using pip install yotta, we are going to use pip 3 install yotta. While yotta is downloading, we can check the next step, that is to install srecord. So we copy paste this line and we also execute it when yotta is finished. One final dependency to take into account is the ARM GCC that yotta used to build the code. So let's also install that one. Now we should be ready to run the script. Just press enter for all the questions. Yotta is now downloading all the dependencies. And now the compilation of the code is starting. And the compilation completed successfully. The final step is to copy the hex file inside your MPED. When the sync command is complete, you can unplug your MPED and you can enjoy playing the breakout game. This is a recording of the actual breakout game playing on a real device. Now that the game is complete, let's take a look at how to optimize it by tuning the compilation of the code. You can check the full list of function attributes at the link below, but be at least familiar with the inlining one that forces short function to be copy-pasted wherever they are used. We can see later how this helps to make the code faster. Another way to make sure that your code runs as fast as possible is to use the compiler options. For example, inlining can be set up as well by the compiler flags at a less fine grain. Other important flags are the optimization levels. Always set -02 or -03 for production code, unless you're running out of ROM, in which case -OS would help reduce the size of your firmware. It is also a good idea to read the manual of your compiler to find out any useful flags that can help your use case. Let's now take a look at how inlining can help. Here you can see an example of a simple function call from another one in ARM assembly. You can clearly see where the main function calls the square function by branching and how the inner function saves the register to the stack pointer, then does its calculation, stores the result, pop the stack and finally branches back to main. Now we use the inline attribute for the square function and the compiler simply embeds this code inside the main to shorten the number of instructions by at least 40%. Inlining a function that gets called in many different places can increase the code size, but it may yield an increase in performance by removing extra stack management and hitting the instruction cache more often. Make sure to always benchmark your code to figure out which functions benefit most from inlining. Since we are coding a video game for a battery-powered device, we should also think about using as little power as possible. We know that the human eye gets the illusion of movement when content runs at 24 frames per second, so we should at least limit the screen update frequency to match that value by sleeping in the main game loop if we run too fast. That also helps to make the game feel more pleasant, as research proved that humans prefer games that run at a low but constant FPS in contrast to games that have a variable FPS. If you feel that making a breakout game for a microcontroller was challenging, you would be amazed at how low were the specs for early Nintendo consoles and how complex were the games running in that hardware. I really recommend that you follow the Game Historian, StraightFox and Displicit Gamers on YouTube for a lot of interesting stories on how those games were made. If you feel that you want to make microcontroller video games but you are too late to publish your hit title on a Game Boy cartridge, the good news is that microcontroller consoles are back and fully open sourced. Here you can see my three favorite ones. The Artboy with its black and white display and only 2.5 kB of RAM, the Pokito, which runs ARM embed and has a nice color display, and the Odroid Go, which is the most powerful of the list. Here is a list that you can follow to get started into microcontroller consoles and get help from those amazing communities. Plus a list of my GitHub repositories where you can find the code of the breakout game and some other games that are developed. The last section of this course is about implementing a small Internet of Things application using the Bluetooth Low Energy functionality of the MicroBit. BLE is an evolution of Bluetooth that is supported by all recent smartphones and that uses very little power. For this project, I used the BLE implementation for MicroBit from Lancaster University. While they implemented services for all the input and output components of the MicroBit, we are going to use only the UART over Bluetooth service to push some data between a phone and a MicroBit. By including MicroBit UART service.h, the online IDE pulls all the dependencies for the project. The code that runs on the microcontroller simply needs to attach the onConnected, onDisconnected and onButton8 events to the message bus and instantiate a MicroBit UART service to MicroBit's BLE service. The onConnect function establishes the connection and then serves an infinite loop where it reads messages and shows them on screen. The onDisconnect function does basically nothing, and the buttonA function sends a message to request new data. There is no more code to write than that, but the API takes care of hunting and maintaining the connection with the other devices. The difficult part is writing the Android companion that receives the request and sends the data to the MicroBit. For this example, I modified the Bluetooth Legat example application to fetch the current temperature from the Norwegian Meteorological Institute and send it to the MicroBit. You can find all the source code in my MicroBit GitHub repo, but we can take a look at the most interesting parts of the code. Here you can see the code that creates the cat service and the XML stream for downloading the current temperature. This is the message handler that, when it receives the button A press on the MicroBit, downloads the current temperature for Trondheim's latitude and longitude. This is the code that handles the actual download of the XML file. Here, the updateTemperature method parses the XML to extract the temperature and save it in a float in a very hackish way. And finally, here is the function that sends the temperature to the MicroBit. We can see in the Android setting that the MicroBit is paired with the phone. The MicroBit is also discovered by the MicroBit Blue application, and the C scrolls in the LED display that stands for connected. Now we can press the last button and the UPD message scrolls as the MicroBit asks for an update to the Android application, but nothing happens. Now we open the UART demo in the phone and we try again to ask for an update. The phone's answer with the current temperature, that is a quite warm 17.3 degrees Celsius for October in Trondheim. That was all, and I hope that you enjoyed this course as much as I would have enjoyed having someone teaching me those skills when I was a student in university. Please leave any questions in the YouTube comments, send me an email if that works better, and I'll try to answer as soon as I can. Thanks for watching, and I hope that you get inspired by this video to create your own projects.